And the only way we can get there is to for you to be aggressive and be militant about the fact that those are your airways. The only reason you let corporate America have those airways is because they have a responsibility to you. And we forgot that in the U.S. And so Ronald Reagan, the Borax man, one of the first things he does as president, he signs an executive order that does away with the Fairness Doctrine. The Fairness Doctrine was very logical. It said if you want neocon nuts like Rush Limbaugh and Hannity and Ann Coulter talking their hate, if you want hate talk 8 hours a day, then you have to have talk that talks about compassion and our care for other people. And we have to have talk that talks about the wisdom of taking care of the least of our society. He signed it. One of the first things he did in 38 years of the Fairness Doctrine disappeared. And then what ends up happening is the next thing that had to happen is you had to have a way to prevent these inheritance babies from coming to your town and saying, gee, I want to buy your newspaper. And I want to own your newspaper, and I want to own your radio, and I want to own your television, and I want one channel. And the channel is my idea for a new America. The Committee for New America, that's who I'm talking about. You know who these people are. So the person that delivered that, unfortunately, FDR understood why that was important. He understood you could not have industrialists gain control of the networks. He knew that. He knew it because he had seen it happen in Italy with Mussolini, where the industrialists come to Italy and they buy everything. And before you know it, peasants, people that can barely afford food, are thinking that the industrialist has their best interest. And the rise of fascism rose quickly. And FDR had the wisdom to understand that. Unfortunately, the second part of that step, that was the first foot. The second foot after the Fairness Doctrine, it was that we had to be able to have conglomerates grow any way they want to without meaningful regulations. Because the trickle-down is going to take care of itself. You know, if you give these corporations more money, everybody's going to do better. You know, everything's going to be great. We're going to stand around a campfire and sing damn kumbaya at the end of the process. Everything's going to be okay. So what ended up happening is Bill signs legislation that makes that happen. 1996, he signed the Telecommunications Act. And you know what? Then it all started to happen. Why did he sign? I got to tell you this. You know, people ask, why did he do this? It's more psychological analysis than it is historical, but here it is. Bill Clinton thought the media loved him. Bill Clinton believed that he was the next John F. Kennedy, and they were in love with him. The truth is, the tragedy of that love story, they never even had a crush on him, despised him, cost him his presidency, ladies and gentlemen. Who did that? The very people he empowered, the Rush Limbaughs, the Hannitys, the Coulters, all these people that he never saw coming. And his presidency ended up in a demise. So after they gained control of all that, they then understand that now the media, the conglomerate media, those five people in charge, all it is it's about the numbers now, don't you see? It's not about content. It's about the numbers. The numbers are how do we make a better bottom line? And it all becomes important to do away with news. I interviewed Bill Moore not long ago. He told me, Mike, news in the U.S. is dead. Helen Thomas 3 days ago told me, Mike, news in the U.S. is dead. It doesn't exist anymore. So they fired the best investigative reporters. They closed down their departments. And you know what they gave us? Paris Hilton. All of a sudden, news is replaced by infotainment. Like, I really care who in the hell Paris Hilton is dating today. Or I care that Britney Spears is going to have another baby and what the name is going to be. But that's called infotainment. And you know why it happened? Because the conglomerates knew the U.S. public very well. Here's what they knew. They knew we now read and comprehend on a 7th to 8th grade level. That's what they knew. And they knew we could give them entertainment. And we can ignore the fact that a U.S. president is committing murder every day in Iraq, has murdered 70,000 Iraqi men, women, children, because we want to wonder what the hell Paris Hilton is doing. And infotainment is replacing our ability to get our arms around issues that involve people's lives. How can you look at what's happening? It allows us to ignore things like Haditha, where children laying in bed were shot with a damn M1. How does that happen? How do we get so sideways? Well, I got to tell you something. There's a great writer. His name's Larry Beinhart. Many of you probably know him, have read him. Wag the dog. Larry Beinhart said there's a new soma. There's this new drug that's hit America. And it has the same effect as a frontal lobotomy in America. And he says it creates something called fog facts. Fog facts are such that we don't know what in the world the news is. We only get bits and pieces. Do you know you could cross the border into the southern part of the United States and they don't have a clue as to whether or not the President of the United States engaged in black bag operations in domestic spying in their homes? They don't know and they don't care. All they care is who's going to win American Idol next time. That's what the media has been successful in doing. You can ask them, do you think torture really took place at Gitmo and Guantanamo? Were people really so inhumanely treated? And they say, you know, I'm not sure. There's many sides to that. That's fog facts. That's fog facts at work that will eat up your media the same way they ate up our media if you allow that to happen. And I tell you again, we can't allow it to happen. Line in the sand right here. This is it. This is it. Let me tell you how bad it's gotten. For every three, now this is television, let me move this. For every 3 hours on television that talks about nutty, crazy, the kind of stuff you watch and you go, my God, where did they get that? For every 3 hours that takes place, 1 minute of progressive talk. I'm on MSNBC from time to time. I'm like an alien. They bring me on MSNBC, I'm like a crazy rabid dog, a bomb-throwing communist, for God's sake. They can't relate. But that's where we are. That's what's happened here. And so what we did with Air America is we put together a team. It was like our last shot. Air America was failing. The management was awful. Al Franken, Garofalo, Bobby Kennedy, myself, Bob Glazer, a lot of these people y'all know, we all came in together. We said, we have to save this. This is the last message out there. There was nothing else. There was nothing close beside Pacifica Radio. They couldn't do it alone. So we put our team together. And we launched Air America Radio, telling us it's impossible. People don't want to hear it, but we knew the difference. We had done we did our homework. We knew what it really meant. There is a hole in the market, and I'm telling you this so you can take this to your home. There is a hole in the market, and the hole in the market is because there is an oversaturation of neocon talk. And the market always takes care of itself. You can move into that. We know what the numbers. It's 42% of the population, in U.S. anyway, are dying for progressive talk. They can't get enough, and that's what we've learned. Let me tell you how the market takes care of itself. This is the best example. The market takes care of itself this way. 40% of the American public doesn't trust the news media. I mean, it's staggering. 30% say they have so little trust that they have abandoned the main source that they've used for years because they don't trust it. 60% believe that journalists are not permitted to tell the truth. That's what's up in the U.S. right now. I want to talk to you about this. What's happened is it's given rise. Here's the positive end of this. It's given rise to something called citizens' media. No different from John Peter Zinger taking on the British Empire, Thomas Paine, where they had a citizens' media that they ran the risk of sedition. They could have been thrown in prison. Some of them were. But the citizens' media is rising up in the U.S., and you are part of this. If you want to be engaged in Canada, there are so many parts to this, and all of those parts are important. First part, satellite radio, XM and Sirius. Your content, I doubt there's anybody in this room that could not turn out better content for your personal program than anybody working with Air America. You're creative, you're great writers, you have a mind, you're committed, you're motivated. Content is all they care about. They're dying for content. Go to the satellite radio with content. How about this? Have you seen the documentaries that are on video casting now? Unbelievable. Kids that are 18 years old. 18-year-old kids that are turning out documentaries that really mean something to us. Or how about independent newspapers, independent magazines? How about this? How about the blogging? 60 million blogs out there. You know what rises to the top? You know what rises the quickest to the top nowadays? Progressive content. Good, solid, progressive content. That's what they're looking for. It's the media. It's the American public saying, by God, I'm tired of it, and I'm going to fight back. The iPod, always looking. Go to eTunes sometimes. You'll find out how important it is for content. If you go to the EPOD page, you'll find they need content. They need a variation.